Hey, what is up, guys? Welcome back. So today I wanted to make an in-depth guide on just basically everything that I know about gems. This video is probably going to be very, very long. I'm just going to be going through everything that I know, and I'm just going to probably some of it also isn't like directly related to gems, but it's also I think it's really it has something to do with gemming, because gemming is it's a math game basically. The way you work your gems is basically you want to reach the optimal results while keeping you know, certain stats the way you want them to be for certain scenarios. So think of it like this. You know, if you want a monster to farm Golem Speed 10, for example. Alright, maybe not that many people are in Golem Speed 10. Maybe Golem Speed 7, for example. You definitely want that monster to be able to do enough damage so you can, you know, obviously kill shit. And you want that monster to be relatively tanky so that monster can survive and sustain and basically, proceed through the level and clear it, you know. So, you definitely want to have a balance of pretty much everything, you know, when it comes to like dungeon farming. But then there are cases where if you're running, like, for example, like me, who runs like a YOLO Dragon's B10 team, then you want to have like just as much damage on your nuker as possible and just not really care about attack. Or if you're running a arena comp where you're running nukers, you want that nuker to basically do a lot of damage and not worry too much about their defense and HP or recovery. So stat distribution for monsters is definitely really, really important. A lot of times when I'm reviewing monsters, when I look at monsters, I don't just look at their skills, because although skills are very, very important, stat distribution actually plays a huge, huge part within the game. It's all part of a math game, really. It has to do with like it's just a numbers game basically. You want to push these numbers to a certain degree, and you know, you basically I think half of it is stats. The other half is actually the skills of a monster. There are cases where the skills of a monster plays really well with the stats. For example, if you have like a monster with Hunter who has extra critical hit damage, the way you would gem that monster would be a little bit different from the normal way that you would gem, you know, a monster that doesn't have that extra amount of crit damage. So first things first, I'll be looking through basically all the gems and just kind of going through everything that you know you guys will probably need to know for gems. I'm not gonna talk too much about lower tier gems. I don't think. I think most of the time lower tier gems are actually temporary. You can use 4-star gems. You can basically go through the normal maps, get 4-star gems, and those 4-star gems will basically be enough for you to get yourself into Golem's B7, and once you're into Golem's B7, you will have access to 5-star and 6-star gems. So you don't have to worry too much about like the lower tier 3-star, 2-star, 1-star gems. A lot of those gems are definitely just temporary. Just keep basically this, like, these general rules in mind when you're gemming up monsters. Depending on the type of monsters that they are. So we'll take, for example, I think we'll start with a normal element attackers. So this is the RGB type monsters, like, you know, not excluding light and dark, the only you know, fire, wood, and water type monsters. And we'll focus on attackers first. So now, this is also going to be talking a little bit about stats. I'll talk a little bit about stats. For attackers, you definitely do want their main stat, like attack, to be higher. Stat distribution is usually pretty even within the same grade of monsters. So if you take, for example, this Fire Succubus versus this Wood Gatito, she is a natural 4-star and he is a natural 3-star. So if you look at their stats, she has basically a little bit higher HP, she has much higher attack, she has higher defense, and she has higher recovery. So, and her stats in every way possible is better than than the Wood Gatito. But that's actually fair because she is a natural 4-star. If you take a natural 5-star and compare that to a natural 4-star, the 5-star stats will be higher. Like, overall stats will be higher than the 4-star. It's just kind of the way that it works. So In this way, in most cases, 5 stars are stronger than 4 stars. You know, it's just kind of how life works in Monster Super League. I guess it's kind of fair because 5 stars are rare. But then it also doesn't mean that 4 stars are unusable or 4 stars are not worth using, because certain 4 stars do have certain skills and different abilities that, you know, maybe 5 stars don't have. So it kind of weighs half and half, I think. Half of it is stats, the other half is the monster skills. I think a lot of times when people like look at monsters or they give like a review of monsters, most of the time they focus on the monster's passive skills, but a lot of times they don't look at the stats. I actually weigh stats really, really heavily on most monsters. You know, even if a monster has like the perfect skill set, I normally wouldn't consider that monster usable unless it also has the stats to complement that skill set. So, we're gonna start with a normal element attacker. So this is the RGB. I'll just take the Fire Succubus for example. Her stat distribution is really good because she's an attacker, so you want her to do damage. Her skill set also has some combination with her attack, because this is an SP Siphon skill, which means that critical hits heal you, and you would really only want high crit on attack type monsters. So this works really well with the type of monster she is, and this also has defense down, which means that you know, she also provides utility. At the same time, defense down also provides more damage, so this also works really well with attackers. Defense down basically is a utility skill that works well with any type of monster, so it doesn't matter what type of monster she is. So the way normally you would gem these types of attackers, unless they have a special skill that requires them to have a special stat, most of the time, for utility monsters like with defense down and stuff, you would gem with HP, defense, and attack. This way, you have a very good balance of tankiness, because you have like a high HP pool and a high defense pool. It really depends on what type of monster that is, but in most cases, you know, I don't think any monster's stat distribution is too bad. In most cases, their distribution is quite nice, so they have quite like, you know, they won't have like 30k HP with like only 1,000 defense. I think some 2-star monsters actually do have stat distribution like that, but for any monsters that are 3-star and 4-star, that almost never happens. I also don't use any 2-star monsters. I don't recommend using 2-star monsters, but there are some monsters you can temporarily use, like take the 5-stars if you can't get through certain floors, like maybe for Golden's B7 you need a wood healer or something like that. You could use a 2-star monster, but you could also use like an like if you don't want to use a wood healer, you can use a water healer, because you know water is element neutral, and there are some like pretty good 3-star water healers, like the Water Siren, which they give you for free. So I don't think there's any case where you would have to use 2-star monsters. So I probably look through most of the usable 3-star monsters stat distribution, and their distribution is not too bad. They won't have like some really, really messed up distribution when they only have like 1k defense. In those cases, you would, in order to make the monster scale better, you would do like 2 slots, you know, like 2-slot HP instead, because just completely give up on defense, because the base defense is too low for the defense percent to matter. It's all part of math, really. But most of the monsters have pretty even stat distribution. Like when they have pretty high HP, they won't have their defense like too low. Like this monster, for example, the Water Hana, at Evil 3, her defense is definitely a little bit on the low side. Her HP is definitely a little bit higher. But a lot of her stat distribution actually went to recovery, because she is a healer type monster. She's a recovery type monster, so you know, you can't really complain too much about that if you compare her to other 3-star, Evil 3, you know, 4-star monsters. It's actually pretty fair. So In most cases, you would want to gem with one slot HP, one slot defense. This way it provides like a good balance. If you guys learned about optimization in elementary school, you'll know that like, in order to reach the like highest effective HP, like if you played any sort of theory crafting, any types of games you play, you'll know that you want a good balance of a high HP pool and a balance of damage mitigation, and in this case that would be defense. You want to find that optimal point. So you know, it's never too ideal to do like two slot HP attack versus doing one slot HP, one slot defense, and then one slot attack. The reason why you would in a lot of cases do one slot HP defense attack for utility monsters is because most of the time you do want them to survive, and if they're attack type monsters, you don't want to waste their potential attack. So that's why you want to gem with one slot attack. For tank type monsters with utility, I think monsters that are, let me just find something. Like this, for example, if you were planning to use this monster, I had this monster on full attack because I didn't really need her to be tanky. I was only using her for Dragon's B10. But if you're using her for like arena and stuff, for example, you do want her to be relatively tanky. You don't, and her base attack is actually very, very low. So the ideal way to gem her would be to do like, you know, two slot defense, one slot HP or something like that, and just make her like a full tank. And all she does is provide CC. She doesn't have anything like that. Oh wait, no, she needs crit. All right, say, let's just pretend, for example, that this Petrify and Sleep. I think I should probably take another monster for as an example, something that doesn't require crit and still can do the same thing, and still is a defender type. All right, he would work, but he's not defender type. I don't have a monster like that. I might have a monster like that. God damn it. Well, but she needs high HP, so she doesn't work. I guess we'll take the Loki, for example. Yeah, he's a pretty good example. Well, I'll probably go into the Astro guy. It's probably easier to do that. Alright, since I already found the Loki, I might as well talk a little bit about him. Actually, wait, I remembered a monster that was like that. Dark Medusa. Alright, she's not a defender type, but she is a tank type. Now, her skill set basically provides 70% blind and 80% attack down. She is dark, so she does have that like crit damage. You could take that into consideration, but if you're... Just like for 1 second, pretend she's not dark. Pretend she's like grass or something, for example. And she still has the same skill set. Like I think there are some monster like that, similar skill set, with two types of utility skill and not really any sort of like, you know, damaging skill. And that monster is a tank or defender type. For tank types, you would do like two slot HP, one slot defense. For defender types, you would do two slot defense, one slot HP. And the reason you do this is because you don't need, like, if they have really, really low attack, if you use an attack gem, they're not going to do too much attack anyways. So you wouldn't want to, you know, really waste that attack gem. If you're using that monster for PvP, for example, you don't really need that much, like, the extra attack won't really do too much. And you would rather that monster be tanky, so you can use that monster as a tank against certain elements. Say, for example, you're taking her into a fight where they have a light monster, like a few light monsters, and she's a tanky monster that has utility. You can put her in, and she can act as a tank while providing all this utility for your team. So, in these cases where the monster is an attack type, you would do like depending on what type it is. If it's a tank type, in most cases, I'm generalizing. All right, I can't review every single monster in the game, but I'm generalizing. In most cases, you would do two slot HP, one slot defense for tank types, and two slot defense, one slot HP for defender types. For balance types, it's really, really hard to say because balance types are, their stat distribution is really completely random. It's sometimes it's all over the place. Like a lot of times, sometimes you'll see balance type monsters with like high recovery, Sometimes they'll have lower base recovery and then like higher defense. Like that monster will be tankier and not have too much HP. I personally really like balance type monsters because you can gem them any way you want to. For example, like this light Loki, if you really needed to, you could gem him with you can gem him with 2 slot HP, 1 slot defense. I think his distribution is slightly higher on his HP, so you can do like 2 slot HP, 1 slot defense. Or if you want him to provide some damage, you could do HP defense attack as well, and it would still work pretty well. So back on the topic of attackers, there's actually something I think some of you might be asking right now. Like, why would you gem 2 slot, 1 slot? Like, why would you waste 2 of your gem slots with HP and defense when you can do like 2 slot attack or 1 slot crit rate, 1 slot attack, 1 slot HP? The reason for that is because in a lot of cases, your monsters will be under a lot of threat. Normally, you would gem them like this for arena. For some stages of golems, for example, like if you're using her for golem speed 9, for example, you could gem her with 1 slot. Like, you know, since she needs the crit, you could do 1 slot crit, 1 slot attack, 1 slot HP, which is kind of the way you would want to gem her generally because of how this passive skill works. Say for example, this skill didn't exist. She was still a fire type monster with the same skill set. I think there is another monster that is basically just like that, and that would be the where the fuck is she? The Fire Yuki. All right, so she's an attacker type. Her stat distribution is very very similar to the Fire Succubus. I think it's almost exactly the same, with a few minor differences. And she has 2 skills that are both utility skills. They're both defense down skills. So if you're using this monster, for example, for Golem Speed 9 or something like that, you could gem her with 2 slot attack, 1 slot defense, or 1 slot HP. I think HP would be slightly better because she has a higher stat distribution to her HP. Then you can do 1 slot HP, 2 slot defense because of... or not 1 slot HP, 2 slot attack, I mean, for this monster. Because for Golem Speed 9, if you have a strong enough healer, enough sustain, then you wouldn't need to have that much tankiness, you know. It wouldn't be that much of a big deal. Or if you're using her for Golem Speed 8, it would be the same thing as well. You wouldn't need that much tankiness. But for most cases in like arena and PvP, she won't be able to survive, so then you would need to do 2 slot, 1 slot HP, 1 slot defense, 1 slot attack. Most of the time, if you're, especially, like, you would usually gem like that if your gems aren't really good in the first place. So, say for example, you're using some wood monsters for Golem's B7, which is water, and that's why you're using a lot of wood monsters. So we'll just take some farmable monsters, for example. Alright, I'll talk about her later. I was actually looking for the Miho. Wood Miho, who is an attacker type. So, she has 2400 attack. This is actually a little bit on the low side for attackers, but then she is a natural 3-star. A lot of her stat distribution actually went to recovery, which is kind of a waste. But, her stats aren't super, super good. But she is still relatively decent for Golems B7 if you plan to use her. You would normally take her to around level 50, you know, 5 stars max level, and this should be enough for you to clear Golems B7. Now, if you look at her stats over here, her stat distribution is actually really balanced. She might be an attack type, but if you look at her stat distribution, this actually looks much, much closer to balance type monsters. Like, a lot of attack type monsters, like if you compared her max stats, for example, to like the Fire Succubus or Fire Yuki, for example, she actually has the same amount of HP, around the same amount of HP, but much, much lower attack and much, much lower defense. So I think she's actually, like, her stat distribution, a lot of it went to HP and recovery, which actually makes her her stat distribution a lot closer to, you know, a balanced type monsters would be. If you're just gemming this monster at level 50 for Golems B7, I would still recommend you gem with 1 slot HP one slot defense and one slot attack, mainly because you don't need any sort of extra damage in order to survive in Golem's B7. The B7 boss also doesn't have any sort of sap. He doesn't have any sort of like just any really really threatening skills that like that would, you know, somehow fuck you over. So you don't need any sort of like resist or any, you don't need to have anything fancy basically. And if you just want to, if you just want the safest run, the easiest run through Golem's B7, I would recommend you gem like monsters a little bit tankier, because you would just, all you really need to do is be able to survive, and then with one slot HP or one slot attack, you would still be able to do some decent amount of damage. And that's mostly true for a lot of the attack type monsters. Like if you're using the Kokomon for Golem's B7 as well, you would still gem him the same way. As you can see, his stat distribution is actually pretty balanced as well. So you can do, you know, one slot HP, one slot attack, one slot defense, kind of the same way you would gem the Wood Miho. And even for tank type monsters, I would still recommend you gem like that. Like if you're using the Wood Mona, for example, for Golem's B7, she is a defender type monster, so her defense is definitely a little bit higher. Her attack is a little bit lower, and the reason why I would still recommend you gem one slot HP for B7 is because you don't need her that tanky. Like she has, if she doesn't have the self-sustain skill, you really don't need her to be this tanky, like to be able to survive, because the other monsters that are going to the level are going to be taking the same amount of damage that she does. So having her any tankier than the other monsters really makes no difference at all. So you can basically gem with one slot attack. She does have that taunt, so meaning that, you know, in a lot of levels she might take a little bit more damage, but it's also alright, because even if you gem one slot attack, one slot HP, one slot defense, her base HP and defense is already higher than attack type monsters, meaning that she is still going to be naturally tankier than these type of monsters, even if you gem them all the exact same way. So, and that is why I recommend you do, like, you know, one slot HP, defense, attack on probably majority of monsters when you're of these normal monsters when you're going through the levels, unless they have some sort of really special skill that requires them to have either, you know, much higher crit rate, or I think most of the time is crit rate, it really isn't anything else. Sometimes it's like resistance for healers, but then I wouldn't recommend you put resistance on a main slot in a lot of cases as well. So yeah, that's pretty much it for like normal type attackers, defenders, tanks, balance type monsters. We're going to talk a little bit about healers. You know? Healers are a little bit unique. I think healers are, you're able to gem a lot of monsters in a lot of different ways. So in most cases, if you want just stable runs, I would recommend you just gem healer monsters, depending on their stat distribution, with 2 slot HP, 1 slot defense. Most of the stronger healers don't really need any sort of recovery. Like she has 2,600 recovery, which is actually relatively high. I really don't think that a lot of healers don't need that extra recovery. But it really depends on what type of healers they are. I don't think the healer's main job, like I seriously don't think that healers in this game, their main job is to actually heal. Their main job is to provide whatever utility skill that they have that is tied along with their heal. I think that's much, much more important. And that's why you have like really strong monsters, like the strongest healers are definitely the ones with shields, or the ones with like some sort of you know, crazy buff that makes your team like insanely OP. And a lot of times it's not really, it doesn't really have to do with their heal. I really don't recommend you put recovery on, like just one slot recovery on a lot of your healers. Most of the time they don't need it. Like I really think they don't need it. I don't think that that's true for all healers. There are actually some healers that actually have much, much lower recovery. A lot of times, like the Curas, for example. If you're trying to use one of the Curas as your main healer, say, for example, you have, like, the, like, Wood Cura or something for Golems B7. Or if you're using, like, the Water Cura for Golems B7. Like, the Curas are, like, tank types. I think the Fire Cura is a recovery? I'm not sure. I'm not too sure. I actually can't remember. The Fire Cura... yeah, is a recovery type. So her recovery is actually a little bit higher. But if you compare it to like the Hanas, for example, their recovery is much, much better than the Curas. So it's not always true. I think recovery gems could work on the Curas just to boost their recovery up a little bit if it isn't high enough. Mainly because of how their gems work, or their skills work. So I'll take the Wood Hana, for example. At Evo 2, 5 stars max level, like the type of level you would be going into Golems B7 with, she already has 2100 recovery. So I don't recommend you put another recovery gem on her because it's already high enough. But she is kind of lacking in her, like, defense and stuff. Like, her HP and defense are a lot lower. So you could do two slot HP, one slot defense. But then if you look at monsters like the Water Cura, for example. Like over here. You know, her at 5 stars max level Evo 2, she only has 1,200. So you could... but she has a little bit higher HP and defense. I think higher than the Wood Hana, if you take a look. Actually, wait, no, her stats are just shit. I just realized. Oh no, she has 2,400. So she's actually relatively tanky. Like her base HP is a little bit higher, and so you could actually get away with just gemming one slot HP defense, and then you can use recovery to boost the recovery up a little bit. I only recommend doing this on lower levels. Like what I said before about the recovery gems, about like most of the time you wouldn't want to ever put them on healers. I'm mostly talking about like healers that are max level, like Evo 3, 6 starred, and like I'm talking about like 6 star gems and stuff. It might just be a personal preference, but a lot of times, like, I really don't think... most of the time when you're using healers, you're using them for their utility. Another monster, for example, like the Wood Cupid, if you're going into Golems B7 again, I always take Golems B7 because, you know, most people either got through Golems B7 or they're at the stage of getting into Golems B7. I think it's pretty good basis to base everything around. The Wood Cupid, for example, his recovery is relatively high. And even if his recovery was low, like say for example, if his recovery was only 1,200 and his stat distribution it went to something useless, like attack instead, I would still gem him with one slot. I would still gem him with two slot HP, one slot defense, mainly because his HP is, base HP is really, really low. His defense is actually a little bit higher. I might do one slot HP, two slot defense to boost it up a bit. And the reason why you don't need really high recovery on him is because he's not actually there to heal. He's actually there to put up this shield. And if he's able to put up the shield, it means that he's able to mitigate even more damage. So it kind of acts like as a heal, like a pseudo heal basically, like the shield. Because it's already able to mitigate some form of damage. So recovery isn't as useful on him. Instead, if his other stats are lacking, you would try to boost those stats up with another main slot instead. You only have 3 slots to work with, so the types of main slots that you can gem up monsters with is a little bit limited in the game. You kind of just have to make do with what you can, especially on monsters that have like stat distribution that is a little bit poor. I'm not saying his was poor, I was just pretending that if his recovery was low. It's kind of the same thing for Wood Cura as well. Like, you can see, her recovery is a little bit low, and if you want to boost it up a bit, you could slap one recovery gem on her, and her base HP is actually relatively high, and she also has adrenaline. Even if she didn't have the adrenaline, I would still, like, you know, put a recovery gem on her, for example, just to make sure she's able to you know, provide a significant amount of heal when I'm actually healing. But I feel like it's definitely a little bit overkill when you're at the point where you're using 6-star gems and your monster is like completely max out, you know, max level and stuff. Because in a lot of cases, their heals are actually meant to... It's more about the utility that they provide rather than the heal that they provide in a lot of cases. So you see me gemming my Dark Hero with like one slot attack to... Because I don't need her that tanky, so I don't need her to really provide any sort of bonus recovery, so I basically just, you know, decided to slap one attack gem on her because I can, you know, that's just kind of how it works. So yeah, that's pretty much it for normal element healers. The other thing is resistance. I think resistance is actually a really, really interesting topic. It's a very interesting stat because it's actually something that has nothing to do with any of the other stats. What resistance does is it provides a chance for that monster to basically resist any sort of random debuffs that might get put on them. There's currently no counter to resistance, which is why it's really, really sought after in high-end PvP, because a lot of cases, if you're able to resist certain skills, it actually makes certain monsters, even if they have very, very powerful passive skills, make them a lot more useless. So resistance is definitely a really, really important stat in the late game, especially when you're getting into high-end PvP. It's kind of the where the only kind of the not I wouldn't say the only place, but kind of the more common place where it's going to be used. There are certain titans, if you're doing clan battles, that you don't want, like the water one that seals you and stuff, you want to be able to resist that and stuff. So resistance definitely does help a bit. I don't recommend focusing on resistance for lower levels of anything. You know, there was a time where I thought, like, I needed high resistance to be able to survive and golems B9, but that actually isn't true as well. Because you can actually survive in Golems B9 if you just like throw in two healers and stuff. And as long as they're tanky enough, they'll eventually kill the boss. There's also another way to get through, you know, B9 if you have monsters with strong self-sustain. Then it doesn't really matter if he saps you, because you can just sustain that damage back. Just as long as you have enough sustain, you can get through that level relatively easily. The thing about resistance is why I actually started to talk about it is actually it's somewhat important on your healers, especially if you're using an active healer for stages like Golems B10, because the Golems B10 boss actually has a chance to silence your monsters. So in any stages where the boss has some sort of either really threatening skill that can like possibly one-shot your healer, like some sort of armor break or silence that can completely mess your heals up, you do want some resistance on your healers. So if you're taking a healer into Golems B10, I do recommend you put some high resistance on that healer. That being said, I don't recommend having resistance as one of your main stats, because in a lot of cases it's actually overkill. You normally don't need your resistance that high. It does max out at 85%, but in a lot of cases it's usually okay even if you aren't able to completely max out that resistance. Like, I use my Dark Cupid for Golems B10, and yeah, he does it pretty well. He almost never gets silenced by the boss. You know, even if he has 85% resist, he still has a chance to get silenced by the boss. So, it's kind of a hit or miss stat, but you definitely do want a little bit of it, because it's better than having none of it and always getting silence, you know. So yeah, that's pretty much it for the normal elements and all the healers. The other two elements I wanted to talk about is the light dark. The reason why light dark monsters are a little bit special is because their stat distribution is a little bit different. Well, not their main stat distribution, but the The crit rate, crit damage, and resist stat distribution is a little bit special on light and dark monsters. If you look over here, light monsters have a base crit rate of 20% but have no resist. Dark monsters have a crit damage of 100% but no resist. What this means is, in a lot of cases, in earlier levels of dungeons, especially in earlier golems like B7, I wouldn't say earlier levels, but like, you know, B7, B8, B9, actually resistance is somewhat important. B10, I don't think resistance is too important on your attackers. So like B7, B8, B10, where resist isn't really all that valuable. I think dark, light and dark type monsters are relatively powerful because they have a bonus stat built in, especially dark monsters. I don't think it's really worth trading 20 resist for 10% crit in most cases, but unless it's a monster where it's like a straight out nuker. For dark monsters, I definitely think it's worth trading 20% resist for 50% crit damage. You know, and that's why I think like dark monsters are definitely the strongest in the game. My favorite element is definitely dark, and the reason why dark monsters are gemmed differently is basically because of the crit damage. You would almost always want to gem one slot crit rate. This is true for aggressors, this is true for attackers, this is true for, alright, maybe not passive healers, but even balance type or tanky monsters, it would still usually be worth it to gem one slot crit rate. It would be better than gemming one slot attack in a lot of cases, even for tank type monsters, to yield higher damage. If you're gemming a full nuker, you could do one slot crit rate, one two slot attack. The most ideal way to gem any monster with the highest amount of attack is to use the ruin set, two slot attack, one slot crit rate on dark monsters. Now the other thing I kind of forgot to talk about is actually for normal attackers, if you're planning on using two slot attack versus one slot crit rate, one slot attack, and then one slot either HP or defense, which is better? In most cases, two slot attack will give you the higher overall damage. There are some cases where you want to gem one slot crit rate. Usually, that's if you're using a ruin set, you could do one slot crit rate, and then that would actually give you higher attack because it gives you 40% extra crit damage, and then it would be like if you're using a dark monster, you know. But it also has to do with the substat of your gems. So, you could do, or if that monster requires you to have higher amounts of crit rate, you know, like the Fire Succubus, Fire Vampire, and stuff like that, where you need to have like near 100% crit rate, then you would do one slot crit rate, one slot attack, one slot either HP or defense. But for most dark monsters, you would pretty much always gem one slot crit rate because it yields the higher amount of damage. That isn't always true. For some tank type monsters, I might actually do, you could actually do, if you have some nice crit rate substats, to push maybe close to 50, even just close to 50%, like 40% or something, you could do one slot attack, one slot HP, one slot defense. Like you would gem normal utility non-dark monsters. Like for example, the Dark Medusa, I think, is a pretty good example, because she is a dark type monster that is a tank type who only provides utility. So I don't think it's really worth it to do one slot crit rate on her, even though she has that nice crit damage. But because of the base crit damage, I would try to push as much crit rate substats as I can on her, as much as I possibly can. And yeah, that's pretty much it for dark monsters. For dark, normal attack type aggressors, like aggressors, you would do like whatever type of aggression they have. I think it's pretty straightforward. For aggressors, you would do, if it's a defense aggressor, you would do crit rate, double defense. You know, for dark, aggressors, you would do crit rate, double defense. Or for HP aggressors, you would do crit rate, you know, double attack. For light type monsters, for light, any sort of light, well, we'll start with attackers first. For light attackers, it actually really does depend. Normally, for light type utility monsters, you would still gen the same way as any of the normal element utility monsters. Mainly because they do have 10% more crit rate, but it doesn't really matter. Like, it doesn't actually affect anything. Like, this resist being moved to crit rate actually doesn't, it doesn't really matter for utility monsters, because all they really need to do is provide whatever utility they have. So going back to the example of the light Loki or anything like that, you know, who only provides utility, and he has a balance type, so you could do either, you know, one slot HP, one slot defense, one slot attack, which is probably the normal way you would gem most balance type monsters. Or you could do, you know, if you want to make him tanky, you could do like two slot HP, one slot defense and stuff like that. And then you can put him in the arena to tank against dark type monsters. And yeah, that's pretty much it for utility monsters. For light aggressors, because aggressors are only light and dark, and for most light aggressors, you would want to do like three gems of whatever type of aggression they have. So for defense aggressors, you do like three slot defense. For HP aggressors, you can do three slot HP. This is for like pure aggressors. For hybrid aggressors, it really depends, because it depends on whatever other skill they have. Like the light Mona, for example, she needs crit, so I would do one slot crit rate on her. But for monsters like light Victoria, it doesn't really matter. For monsters like light Shiva, who first skill also needs HP, it doesn't matter for him. You would still do three slot HP. For light Jean, who both her skills are HP aggression, you would do double, triple HP. You know, it's pretty straightforward for light type aggressors. And I think that's it. I think that I covered every single type of monster in the game already. There are always unique cases. There are certain monsters that have very, very unique skills that need to be gemmed a certain way. For example, monsters that have, like, you know, both skills need 100% of crit or something like that. Or that monster, you know, is... I don't think there's too many exceptions. I think this is probably the way you would gem every single type of monster. Okay, so moving on. The next little topic I wanted to talk about is gem sets. Gem sets are somewhat important, I think. If you look at a lot of my monsters, it really does depend on what type of gems you have lying around, because there's always the ideal gem set, but then there's the gem sets that you have. So for gem set, my recommendation would be to use whatever gems have the best substats. It really doesn't matter. Even if you have to sacrifice using a set, it would still be worth it if you can push together all the type of stats that you need, you know, for a certain gem set. A good example, I think, is my Dark Thor. I think his gem set's really, really good. You know, even though it's a broken set, I think it's still really, really nice to be using these gems, because they have really, really nice substats. So for gem sets, most of the time I do ignore gem sets. Well, I don't completely ignore gem sets. I try to put a set together, and if it works, I use it. If it doesn't work, and you know, I can do better without the gem set, then I use a broken set. It's just it really is just that simple. Like, now, there's always the question of, like, you know, Valor versus Ruin. In most cases, if you have the proper substats, Ruin will usually be better, because it's much easier to push 20% attack with substats than it is to get 40% crit damage with substats. So in most cases, Ruin would be better. Intuition is mostly for monsters where you need high crit rate. Even monsters that could use the crit rate, like, it doesn't really matter. Like, for example, I think this is a good example. My light Victoria, who's on triple intuition, she has a fair amount of crit rate, but she doesn't have any sort of crit damage. But she is gemmed with like three slot defense, so she's a pretty nice, well gemmed aggressor, I think. And, you know, the crit rate doesn't actually really matter. It doesn't really provide any sort of overall increase, like that much of an increase to her damage. But I think it's still nice to have. Like, it's still nice to have as a bonus, because if, when she's critting, you know, she'll be dealing at least 50% bonus damage. So crit rate, I think it's still a really, really effective way to boost up attack. So intuition is pretty much useful on any monster, you know. Conviction, I think most really, really high ranked arena players would think that this is probably the best set in the game, because of how much they value resist. Conviction is really, really nice depending on the substats that you have, because with a conviction set, what you can do is you can actually push your resist up really, really high, past the point of, you know, the cap, and you don't have to sacrifice any of your main stats to do that. So if you have some substats with resist and they're in the conviction set, then those are really, really good gens, because you can use them for pretty much any type of monsters. Like for tank monsters, you would still need resist. For attack monsters, you would still need resist for the arena. So conviction set is really, really good as you get into the late game. Protection and life. Usually I treat protection, life, vitality, most of these sets as broken. But there are some exceptions. Like, you know, if you have like an aggressor, HP aggressor, you ideally would want to gem that monster up with like 3 slot gem of life, with all HP. Or if it's a defense aggressor, you know, 3 slot defense, all HP, or all defense, if you can. I think that's pretty much it for gem sets. Now there's one like other scenario where I would say ruin. Like I think if you had all the perfect substats in the game, ruin would probably still be the best set in the game. The reason why ruin isn't as highly valued as some of the other sets is because ruin relies on your crit rate to be high for this set to be even be useful. What this means is you either need to have really good substats on your ruin gems, or they're useless. And if you take, for example, like if I'm using an aggressor like the Light Victoria, where she needs as much defense as possible, if you want her to have like the highest amount of effectiveness, you would think that you would put 3 slot, you know, protection, all defense gems on her, and this would yield the highest amount of effectiveness, because she's a defense aggressor, so she would be tankier with that set, and she would be able to deal more damage because of the high amount of defense. But in the most ideal case, ruin would actually provide the highest amount of effectiveness if you had the proper substat to back it up. So say for example you have 3 gems that are all defense ruin with like 30% crit rate. You can actually push her crit rate all the way to max and basically sacrificing 20% defense for 40% crit damage when you have 100% crit rate. The 40% crit damage would be higher value than the 20% defense, because you would be doing much, much more damage with the bonus amount of crit damage from every single hit that you do. So it actually yields the higher amount of effectiveness, but it doesn't make her tankier in any way. Like if you do the defense set, it still makes her tanky. But I would sacrifice that amount of tankiness for like if you weighed tankiness and amount of damage she deals like evenly, then the ruin set would yield higher effectiveness because of the much, much higher bonus amount of damage that she would deal if you could push 100% crit rate with only substats, you know. But yeah, that's kind of like almost an impossible scenario. So in most cases, you would do like triple defense and stuff like that. And I think that's pretty much it. I think that's all I really have to say for gemming up monsters. I mean, it's been a little bit long. Now, the other thing, like just one, the last thing I kind of want to leave you guys with is the grade of your gens that you're using. So I have over here on my Google Chrome this is from the wiki, and this actually goes and tells you all the amount of whatever attack, HP, defense, resistance, crit rate when you max out a certain grade gems. So this is for 4-star. You know, if you have like a crit rate gem at 4-stars and it's maxed out, it only gives 37.2. At 6-stars, it gives 55. You know, at 5-stars, it gives 45. So in a lot of cases, I think there are certain ways that you wouldn't gem a monster with a certain grade of gems. Say for example, you are at the point where you're only progressing, you're trying to build a Golem's B17, and all you have are 4-star gems. You don't have any sort of other better gems. The only gems you have access to are 4-star gems. If you had a Dark Aggressor or anything like that, you most likely wouldn't do triple, you wouldn't do crit rate double defense, because the crit rate, even if you max out a 4-star gem, would be 37, and it's definitely not worth the gold to max it out. So even if you get it to plus 12, it's only 28%. 28% would be too low to make the effect of the crit damage, you know, matter all that much. So you would actually be able to have higher effectiveness if you gem that monster up with triple HP or triple defense. Like say for example you had a Dark C star, but you only had access to 4-star gems. I would still recommend you gem that monster with triple defense rather than one slot crit rate, two slot defense. Do you kind of get what I'm saying? Because of the grade and the limited amount of gems that you're, or the grade of gems that you're limited to. God damn it, I can't talk. I've been talking for way too long. You know, you would still do triple defense instead of HP. For 5-star gems, I think if you're willing to max out a 5-star gem, you could actually use crit rate here. But for 4-star, you probably wouldn't do that. If you're using like filler gems that are lower than 4-stars, you definitely do not want to use like crit rate. You definitely don't want to use resistance, because this is actually just way too low for anything to matter. And yeah, you probably wouldn't want to use crit damage as well, because crit damage is hard to push. It's only effective if you have the amount of crit rate necessary to make that crit damage effective. So for lower tier gems, you would mostly gem monsters up with HP defense attack. Just follow the general rule of HP defense attack. You can probably never go wrong. Like if you're using any monster in like B7, B8, B9. You know, doing HP defense attack on any monster would pretty much be right. You know, you can't go wrong with that. So yeah, that's the TLDR, or TLDW. If this video is too long to watch, gem all monsters with HP defense attack, you can't go wrong. Like, there's probably better ways to gem certain monsters, but you cannot, it wouldn't be wrong to gem a monster with HP defense attack. Like, any monster with HP defense attack. And yeah, that's pretty much it. So hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. I've been talking for a long time. And yeah, this is just my guide sharing my experiences on gemming up monsters. I don't know if you guys enjoyed these longer guides. I think a lot of you guys do really like them. So I think I'll start making some guides very, very soon. Especially some in-depth stuff, like, you know, moving on in the next video, how to gem monsters only for arena and stuff like that, and then I can go into a lot more specific you know, meta monsters in detail. And that is pretty much it. So thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace out.